this is a new experience for him. One, he's captaining. Two, he's playing on the last team TI. If anything, this is like a first for him, much like his teammates. So there's a ton of pressure on his shoulders. It's going to be tough. He's really just going to try and put all that behind him.
You said it's a new experience for Misery, but if you compare it to Saxa, who last November, like who would know who Saxa is? He was just a high MMR player. Four Clovers and a Leprechaun bring him in, all of a sudden he's TI a few months later.
Wasn't that long ago that we was just a better player that played a couple of heroes.
He played with Balkan Bears, he played with Miracle a lot.
Yeah. Yes.
So
yeah, back in the
Balkan
day.
Bears is where the new Raw Talent set.
Yeah, that's where all the new boys go, and then they come into the pro teams. We've got 30 seconds until our first draft, so let's get our predictions down. Gods!
Today, we're going to beat Bleed Blue and go with EG. I think it's going to be close. But...
Okay.
Oh.
All right, Shiva.
Do I have to?
Yeah. Secret fangirl. Presumably, you go with EG.
You don't go with EG, though.
DC, okay.
2-1.
All right. Shane?
I think it's... this is a hard one to call.
It is.
The draft depends.
The deciding vote as well.
I'm going to go with Cheever. 2-1 DC. It's going to be a tight one, though.
Okay, our panel say 2-1 DC. Let's find out as we head into draft number one.
Seconds remaining. 5 seconds remaining.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome inside Key Arena. For everyone watching at home, we're about to begin game one of our last day of TI6. It's DC versus EG. I'm here at the drafters panel. I've got Blitz, Merlini, and Waga by my side. Blitz, I'll start with you. We have two highly accomplished drafters here. PPD, as we know, former champion. This guy has been around the block. On the other side, we have Misery, who has been to every TI, and he has been looking stellar as a drafter here. Who do you honestly give the leverage to in this one?
Probably PPD. I think that PPD is the player that I question the least coming into TIs now. This is going to be his top three placement for 3 years in a row. Especially with how often the meta changes, there's no way that you can doubt this guy anymore. So I would give the drafting edge maybe to EG. We saw them in this position last year and they flourished.
We'll have to see how that pans out. EG already open up, they get the Shatter Demon, and it looks like we could possibly be seeing Universe on that Faceless Void. Digital Chaos, though, snag up Lady Mirana and go right into their Naga.
Yeah, and this could very well be, while you say that PPD probably has the drafter's edge, DC are an extremely tricky team to draft against, because they do these tricks, and they already did it again here. Picking up the Naga, that could be Mystery on a support Naga, that could also be Resolution on a carry split push Naga, and you now have to be ready for what are you going to ban in the second phase. So EG banning out the Caudal, of course we saw DC before just go into the Vengeful as a carry and just say screw it if you counter a Naga too much. So it's very interesting to see what DC are doing.
I think overall I favor Digital Chaos in the drafting. I think the really successful teams this tournament, like the Digital Chaos, EHOME, Wings, they always do something weird with their lanes. They switch their cores to supports to cores occasionally, and always keep you guessing. I think EG is more individually talented and far more consistent.
On that note of individually talented, a worthy note, Faceless Void. Universe is Faceless Void, 11-0 already in CI.
It's pretty curious that they decided to give it up, considering Wings kind of set the tempo of we're not going to give Universe Faceless Void.
It was also played in the EG EHOME series in both those games, I believe, and he had an amazing performance. They play really well around the Chronosphere and use that cooldown in a very good way.
They didn't first phase it yesterday, though. I think that's where one of the drafting issues lied.
Yeah, a lot of the teams have been going for Faceless Void as fourth pick or fifth pick even. So, a little bit surprising seeing it that early.
So does that maybe imply that this could lean towards a support Naga Siren, getting something to combo break Universe and his miraculous setups usually for these team fights? Because it does seem pretty peculiar that DC are going to let such a power pick through.
Support Naga, it really breaks Faceless Void in many ways. Even though OG had a bad performance here at the main stage, we saw him in the group stage using it, and Crit played really well on his support Naga. I think you can use that against the Faceless Void to just sit back with Naga because of how far away she can be and still save her team.
By the way, during the second phase of bans here, as mentioned, Caudal's gotta go. EG also get rid of that Darkseer, while DC say no to Sumail's Storm Spirit, and they also get rid of the Alchemist.
Still a decent amount of options available for both teams. They've kind of left their draft open. But for EG, you want to pair something with that Faceless Void. A bunch of range heroes really help out. This is the last possible scenario where you just want to draft two melee cores unless you're MVP Phoenix and decide that you'll work around that.
I think they might go into Ogre here on EG. I think Bloodlust is really good with Void, and Zai also plays it really well. The playstyle fits EG. You can also secure mid for Sumail even more. He always does really well in mid lane, but if he has free farm, he just takes over a lot.
They could also go into AM. They have the Shadow Demon on the side, and it's really good versus the Naga Siren, regardless of whether she's a core or a support, but not the best combo with Faceless Void. I also really like the Magic Resist versus Murana. We've just seen Murana like wreck so many cores late game. Kunkka. He's one of the better ones to stand up.
Oh, but we get the Kunkka to come out here, so you get your Shadow Demon Kunkka set up already by EG.
Yeah, that was a hero that DC used quite often yesterday in their series against Fnatic, so not too surprising that EG decided to take it, considering DC also favorite.
I mean, we also saw a ton of teams that have been doing really well this TI have been using it, teams that went pretty far. TNC played the Shadow Demon Kunkka a ton. We saw a lot of different teams really using it. It became more popular during the group stage, and now it's just something you gotta respect.
I think they need something to combo with the Naga, though. The ET's already out, the Keeper's already out, and we haven't seen too many other partners. We see Invoker sometimes, but they already have Murana for that.
Disruptor is pretty good. I like Disruptor against Faceless Void. The only downside for picking that is that Shadow Demon can still save people, right? You still suffer that potential save from SD.
There's even some older ones that we've seen. They used to run like Phoenix Naga or Phoenix with their team fight a lot, but
that's the Soxa Oracle for sure. I was gonna say I think that's a possibility for them, just because I'm thinking of the heroes that Soxa likes to play. Oracle so far to me has been the standout hero for him in this tournament. It works out pretty well against the Faceless Void. It's pretty decent against the Kunkka, just because the boat comes in at you so slowly that you can almost always get the Fate's Edict off.
Yeah, and Saxa is one of those players, he doesn't really need to pair up the Oracle with something in particular. I mean, obviously you now have Murana, so the arrow setup is really good. You have End Snare, you also have the Oracles holding people in place. Oh, the SD Luna combo. Turn to
pick. Alright, so what does this say to us about EG's game plan already? Are they looking to kind of make a higher impact in the mid game, almost 5-man-esque with this Luna a bit?
This is a very PPD type of draft. It doesn't really lack that much in any departments, but it does excel in something, and that's going to be pushing. You have a lot of push coming in from Luna, but the teamfight is also why you can push. Look at these teamfight ultis. The Void, the Kunkka, and the Luna, all of them are really powerful. So it's going to be hard for DC to take the confrontation head on.
It's also really easy to gank lanes for whomever they have, like SD Kunkka, one of the best roaming duos. Then it's really easy to set up into a Faceless Void Chrono, or set up with Disruption into whatever they want to.
I kind of hope that DC are going to pick a different carry than Naga here and run it as a support, actually. I think Naga as a carry is not going to be great against SD in the first place. Just the Illusions taking over the Radiance helps a lot when EG wants to push. And I also don't think it matches up that well against Luna later on. So I wonder what they're thinking right now.
Well, Tidehunter comes out now. It looks like Bermu's hero here, so they still have that last pick if they do want to do any sort of last second audible call. But for now, things building up at least the team fight here for DC.
Really unreliable disable still in DC. Against a hero like Faceless Void, this is going to be hard to play out, I think. Sure, you had a Ravage when you can commit that. But as I said, the team fight's already going to be very difficult to take against EG. And for skirmishes, you don't have that good mechanics to hold down Faceless Void so you can't time walk over and over.
Yeah, I think EG's lineup just might be a little bit faster. They'll play a lot quicker. Tidehunter, in my opinion, is just too slow of a hero in this meta. Oftentimes, with this hero, you usually just want to get a mech, send him to the safe lane whenever the enemy team tries to push, and use the threat of the Ravage to keep your towers alive. But nowadays, teams are just willing to take fights, they'll overrun you. If you don't get a huge Ravage off, then they'll play around that fact and simply just go down your lanes.
I think Tidehunter struggles a lot versus Luna. A lot of magic damage and a lot of high damage instance and right clicks per hit. Very good versus the Kraken Shell, and they have the X to bring him back.
Yeah, and that goes throughout their entire lineup. They have so many heroes that can deal with Tide. Even the Chronosphere is great. In a teamfight, you can actually burst down the Tide if you want to. If you really have to, then you can kill him before he gets Kraken Shell off, since the Chronosphere holds him.
Final ban there by EG was on the Huskar. I suppose when an Oracle or Dazzle or Wisp is in and you don't want to take that risk of that last second cheese,
better to play it safe, I suppose.
Yeah, that's just a good safety for EG. I'm not even sure their lineup would struggle that much with the Huskar, but you always... You have seen what he can do with a Dazzler or an Oracle. It's better to ban it out of it. Reserve time.
And for DC, they look to target what could be the Sumail hero, and they ban out the Invoker, but... Wog, I believe we were talking earlier, we haven't been seeing too much Sumail Invoker recently.
Well, while we might not have been seeing it, there's just three really good setup spells here for Sunstrike, so Exord Invoker would be extremely strong in EG's lineup, and Alacrity on Aluna is also very powerful.
Very true.
Would allow them to push pretty quickly as well, just because you can start sending down Forge Spirits plus the Luna Illusions with the SD.
DC move themselves into the Razor here, so this does seem to be what looks like a core Naga.
They were really low on reserve time. I don't know. I don't really like the Razor here too much. They don't really have any setup, like not that great setup for Marana arrows. Remaining. Like there's very little to keep them in place so you can actually run at them with the Razor.
5 seconds. Do you think they have remaining. To aggro try this game? You go Razor, Naga, Oracle, send them top, and then let...
I think DC have to. Yeah, for sure.
I'm pretty sure they have to aggro try.
Final pick from EG is going to be a Queen of Pain here, gentlemen. Based on our draft before us, who do you think is going to take game number one?
I think EG have the better draft overall.
Yeah, EG, I'm really comfortable with what they have picked here. Even though I normally don't like Queen, I think they still have such a good setup.
Yeah, better lanes, better team fight. That's favorite EG.
Let's see if they do it, ladies and gentlemen. Let's throw it over to our lower bracket final casters right now. It's LD and Mott.
Thanks, Dakota. Ladies and gentlemen, that's right. We are live here on the floor of Key Arena, getting ready for EG versus Digital Chaos. On one side, Mott, you have a team that can only be described as Dota royalty. EG, already a dynasty, top three at the last three TIs. This one guaranteed, looking to become the first ever repeat champions. And on the other side, you have DC, a ragtag band of misfits with a captain who doesn't even want to be the captain. He wants to be the guy next to the captain, facing the man who might be the best guy next to the captain in the world, in fear, as the panel said earlier. So a total clash in styles coming in, but none of that matters now. You said all aside on the main stage.
Yeah, I mean, this is a huge match. DC, I don't think they thought they would get to this point. They just played one series at a time. They positioned themselves to get to a top three berth, but EG feels like it's last year all over again. They're down to the lower bracket. They've been here before. They've been in this position, and EG can certainly take this series. It should be an exciting one here as we'll jump into the game. EG on the dire side. They pick up the SD Luna strat, which was something that Digital Chaos was running a fair bit during the group stages as well. You saw Resolutions Luna, obviously very successful during that group stage. So they'll pick it up this time on the other side for DC. It is going to be the Misery Naga Siren. That means...
This is the curveball of the draft. The question was, would it be a support Naga? Would it be a carry? Resolution has played quite a bit of carry Naga. In fact, that's where DC found a lot of their early success in the tournament was the split pushing heroes for Resolution, whether it was his Morphling. I think that was probably still one of the standout performances of the tournament, or if it's something like the Naga, but indeed the Naga was picked as a counter to the Chrono. We're gonna have an early level one skirmish here down at the bottom rune, though.
They want to fight, they want to make sure they get this bottom rune. It looks like EG will back off. They don't want to deal with that arrow.
Dominance assertive.
DC have said, we'll take this bottom rune. You guys can get the top, we don't mind. And then we'll ship into the laning phase now as Sumail will go ahead and body block, and we'll see how this matchup mid is gonna go. I'm more than interested to see how we'll see Weeha do on this Marana, which he's played a fair bit of as well against Sumail. Matchup we should have seen a little bit more, I think, if we had Pain not getting picked up as often.
It's the aggro tri-lane, the tri-lane for EG, something that teams have been running a lot more with the Shadow Demon Luna duo, and obviously Kunkka provides that reliable follow-up stun after the disruption. A lot of damage from this tri-lane. DC have an okay save, I would say, in the Oracle, but it's not necessarily the best one. And Razor, a hero that is fairly immobile, so only 295 base move speed, could get punished and run down by the Luna, who already starts with the Windlace. EG definitely very good at chasing. DC will have to mind their positioning.
And there is the Lunar Blessing as well. So the Luna, obviously, they already hit a Tauren under Resolution. There's going to be the Shadow Poison as well. Basic will come out, but that might be your first blood. Resolution getting chased down, and it will be! Zai gets it done with a beautiful Tauren setup. And EG get first blood, just like that.
Yeah, PPD not going for the disruption here. This is the build we've seen more often from Shadow Demon's higher damage output at level one with the Shadow Poison. So like you said, just a beautiful setup by Zai. Generally, you don't expect this tri-lane to go for kills until level two or three. So EG off to a great start here in the offensive tri-lane. And they're doing it versus a support duo that needs a lot of experience, Naga and Oracle. And a carry in the Razor that is not the best comeback hero. DC cannot afford for this tri lane to fall apart. They will not get help for some time, as Tidehunter really has to hit level 6 before he can make an impact in any sort of larger scale engagement. And Morana unlikely to join the fight unless she gets a really good rune, so expect DC to have to salvage this solely with the lane. There won't be help sometime.
Yeah, but meanwhile, in the top lane, you still have, obviously, a pretty good matchup for Mu right now with 9 last hits going up against the Universe Void. Now, Universe Void, obviously, is legendary at this point. Going, obviously, I think 9-0 it was during this tournament so far with that Void.
I think it was actually 11-0, but yeah, he has been crazy. He has been a beast on the hero. I think they have some decent solutions for the Void later on in the game. The Song is the big one. Oracle save is so-so, but I think the bigger issue is in the mid-game, just being able to keep the Void under control. As mentioned, there is not much reliable lockdown for this hero, so unless you static link him pretty early in a fight and force him to disengage, he will be difficult to tango with. And he's getting a 1v1, he'll have a fast level 6 to go with that Sumail, as the mid-pop can offer a lot of damage. Like, the synergy for EG around the Chronosphere is just amazing this game, so definitely something DC have to be very mindful of. Lots of setup for Chrono and lots of follow-up. But when it's down, that's where they can look to take the fight. So, other two lanes looking fairly even so far. We do see Mu and Universe going blow for blow. Trading evenly as far as CS goes. Weeha in the mid on Morana. Is falling behind quite a bit though. Sumail is getting the upper hand in this lane as time progresses. Now 9 denies.
The base damage of, I think, the Morana a little bit lower here in the early stage of the game. When you look at Sumail sitting at almost 71 base damage coming out. So he has plenty of damage. He obviously has the Scream of Pain as well, and he can harass with the Shadow Strike if he wants to walk up against Weeha. So Weeha with that Starstorm can CS. Do an okay job getting some good farm right now. But as you said, Sumail with the early advantage. It's really this tri-lane down bottom that's the most interesting thing. EG will move forward, but still not able to find that second kill of the game just yet. The Torn on Misery might set it up. They have the Tidebreaker coming through, but no follow-up. The Sphere is just CSing at this point. Resolution walks up, gives him a Plasma Field, but for now, still a lot of just farming at this stage of the game.
Yeah, for EG, they're really waiting on level 6s on their cores. Morana, a hero that generally doesn't even want to rotate too much until you at least get 7, see if the max Starfall. And of course, Void and Tidehunter. Both these heroes need their level 6s to impact the team fights. But at that point, you'll have to be very careful and call those MIAs quickly. Any of those big team fight ultimates entering this bottom lane can instantly wipe the enemy tri-lane. DC for now is at least outfarming the Luna. Fear not having the best start here, only 12 CS. He's getting outfarmed by a decent margin by the Razor, but Luna is on the flip side a very good comeback carry. This is a hero that can clear stacks quickly, especially with the Shadow Demon. You can stack the Ancients. We may see EG now rotate off the tri-lane. They are going to make a smoke maneuver here, heading towards the mid lane. But Luna is very easily punished if she's left alone. But DC, unaware, at least for now.
They have the disruption ready to go. They're going to try to look for the setup on Weeha, but he is back behind the towers. The wave is pushing in now.
He's very low. A torrent could just kill him.
Yeah, they find it, but he is... got some bottles to regen up at the very least. And he's going to back up. They use the scan, but they're
just
off the
mark. Misses Mott's eye, just barely outside of it.
The Queen of Fate, she's backed up. She's gone to heal. It's only 2v1 if they decide to go for this. He's still so close to the tower. PPD's going to come in and he finds the disruption, but he leaps away as the disruption hits. They still get the torch. They jump in, get the scream. That's more than enough damage as EG get their second kill.
Meanwhile, top lane, a Chronosphere on the move, catching up the Tidehunter before he's hit level 6. Who expects the offensive tri-lane Luna to roam for a gank? EG. Now 3-0 the score. As far as CS goes, slightly behind, mainly Radiant's because of their carry, but outside of that, they're in great shape here. They've got still the Queen of Pain ultimate to work with. Shadow Demon, Tonka, such a reliable roaming duo. And you could tell DC were expecting a gank, but just didn't expect them to be able to catch him that far back. He was really playing defensively, Weehan. It just shows you how much initiation potential this EG lineup really has.
I mean, even with that leap back underneath the tower, they still find him with the disruption and get the torrent follow-up. Just nice plays overall from the supports. And like you said, who expects the Luna to rotate up to that top lane and get a kill? You're missing out on CS, but you get the kill. That's the most important thing. You stop Luke from farming. Disruption, PPD will make the banner and Zox are not there in time. DC support's not really doing much other than helping this bottom lane for now. They're kind of stuck in this down area, this bottom area in the jungle, and trying to pull and keep the lane even. For now, there's nobody else here. They can actually start rotating. Obviously, you saw Luna rotate out of that lane. And we'll see if they decide to send the supports elsewhere to try to look for kills on DC's side.
Yeah, so as for DC, they still have not debuted the Ravage here. Morana yet to really get too active on the map with Weehaw being ganked, but looking at their draft, EG, the much more reliable and scarier five-man lineup, the lineup that is easier to execute in team fights, that has more overall damage, and that I think scales better into the late game. So I definitely do feel like DC need to be making a move here relatively soon. At the very least, try to take some objectives, which you can see bottom. They're trying to chip away at this bottom tier one tower. Moose still sitting top for the time being.
And 5,000 field damage from resolutions. I can't get close anymore. They need some more heroes to rotate in if they want to go for the deny.
They're trying to set up on fear top lane. They do have the Ravage. Oracle initiating. Anchor smash lets it fly. He hits Sumail as well. TP's in almost a bit too early, but he might be here to turn it around. But he has the ultimate winding up. Not going to let it go just yet. Moo in the trees will let him TP out. He wants to hold on to the ultimate for a bigger teamfight combination. Universe also trying to save the Chrono. EG are being very disciplined with their big team fight ultimate usage as Moo will slowly be chipped out, nearly finished off.
Forever.
It is taking forever.
He's gonna get back up, and that'll finally bring him down.
But while that was happening, Resolution gets a free tower bottom, so EG extremely judicious, but this does now mean they have level 4 Scream of Pain, Sonic Wave, and the Chrono ready to go. This will put DC into a very defensive posture come next team fight. No Ravage for some time.
Still, they get the kill with the Ravage onto Fear. Again, stopping him from farming. He's not doing too badly, in fact. He's only a little bit behind Sumail's Queen of Pain at this point. Fear with that kill in the top lane, but him going down to the Ravage. Still a good Ravage usage, but down bottom, it looks like there's going to be misery in the
caught out. But the fog is hurting Sumail. The arrow comes through, just barely dodging it. Misery still survives.
What a juke. What a juke into that fog. And the Insane keeping Sumail in position.
Nerves of steel. Great usage of fog there. Just that single tree screwing over the Queen of Pain. And Misery on the back of that, he closes in on the Song of the Siren. This is the main counter they have to Chronosphere. Will EG fight another opening before Naga hits six? They're going to look for it now. Smoking up Universe and Zai.
I'm going to go through the jungle right now again. You talked about that Chronosphere. They held it for the longest time. They didn't use it to kill Tide. They have it now. There's two heroes bid for DC. They want to set this up. They certainly can. And we'll see if they go for it. They drop the ward down. It's going to be scouted out immediately. There's a sentry there for DC ready to counter it at a moment's notice.
Man, all these rotations from Sumail have really set him back. He was crushing the mid lane before he started ganking. Was winning 1v1 handily in CS. It was like he had like a 3 lasted advantage, 8 or 9 deny advantage. And then he got a gank on his lane, found the kill, was even farther ahead, but multiple rotations now, as well as the death, they have set him back quite a bit. Only at 2.3k net worth, the rest of the team will have to step up a bit. Here comes the boat top!
They're gonna find Moon, they're gonna catch him with the boat, they have the time for Grisful Universe. Chronosphere pops, and they're gonna bring him down with the Luna. They have the Lucid Beam, and that should get the kill. Raindrops will not save him this time, and Moon will in fact drop yet again.
A nice setup there by Universe. Luna does not have the best attack range, but placed the Chronosphere well so that Fear could lay into the Tide. Does delay the mech buildup by a decent margin. I want to point out, though, I like the way Misery is moving his illusions around here. We saw bottom earlier. He was scouting for anybody from EG, potentially, I think, the Void, the main area he's worried about, trying to set up a counter gank where they push the tier 1. Now we see him moving into the enemy jungle with illusions to contest the Luna, to slow down the Void, and also just keep tabs on EG. He is... Naga is not known so much for being picked as a vision-based hero. You know, that's more the realm of like Beastmaster, Nightstalker, who are almost purely picked for that particular purpose. But she does offer something there as DC
that ward
look to make their move. But unfortunately, there is a ward.
Yeah, that ward is greatly placed, and Niji should have seen that smoke come through for DC. And Fear's already making a move towards the mid lane, knowing that he could get caught out very easily by this DC squad. He'll Zion Universe to counter smoke and head maybe towards the bottom lane, although there's no one there, they can head and wrap around on mid as well if they want to try to go for Weehaw. They're just moving away from this DC squad who's trying to invade this mid lane right now. Even Sumail sitting down beneath the tower at this point.
Yeah, EG know when the Chronosphere is down, until Luna and Queen of Pain get items, they are not strong at team fighting. So they dodge. They also managed to scan DC. They now know DC were trying to make a play on mid. So EG, it'll be their turn to play keep away. While DC look for the tier 1 siege.
This is a good tier 1 tower to take in the mid lane. They don't want to fight into Ravage, although there is Chronosphere for EG. They're all down bottom, and it looks like there's going to be a tier 1 for a tier 1 trade. The mid tier 1 for DC is a huge pickup, and they've already taken the bottom tier 1 as well.
There's a glyph here still for the Radiant. A lot of time if they want to defend this mod. They have the Song to set up. Misery comes in. EG could get caught out here.
There we go. Yeah, they're gonna TP more and they're backing away. It looks like EG have an understanding that something is happening here. Here we'll walk forward though. Song not committed. Misery looked like he was going for it, but decided against it at the last moment there.
But Chrono is now online, so EG, they have their insurance policy. Do they look for any sort of smoke, or do they just back away? They TP Fear out. Eyes are on resolution here as he squirms through top. Moonlight Shadow did get activated by DC, but you can see EG are prepared for this. Two Sentry Wards already planted down bottom. They know Moonlight Shadow is one of the biggest threats DC have at this stage of the game.
They should have seen resolution in that top lane again with that ward go into this with the Moonlight Shadow, so they should know there's probably something going on here with DC. And with that happening, they still have the top farming hero, of course, with resolution on that Razor. He has the early Dragonlance coming out, giving him some really good HP and armor, not to mention the range as well, and that's huge.
Standard Razor build, but against Chronosphere, this is especially important to get tanky on your cores, and I think that's one of the reasons why they went for the Razor was, first of all, a relatively strong laning hero if he's not being chain stunned and nuked down, which we saw early, but not so much later on, can just zone out the Luna effectively, and then more importantly, is not an easy hero to burst. They don't have that swap save or a Dazzle Grave. Oracle does better with tanky cores, and now closes in, does have the False Promise. Could be difficult to kill off the Razor inside the Chrono.
Speaking of Chrono, and going back to what you were talking about earlier with Luna's short range, do you think the Dragonlance is a choice that Fear might go for here on this Luna?
Yeah, Dragonlance is just a really easy to build up item. The stats that you get per gold are incredible, so I would be surprised if he doesn't go for it. You could go Yasha, but then he's very squishy, and against Mirana with all the burst she brings to the table, pretty much could be solo kill just by the quadruple Starstorm. Will not have nearly enough HP. Speaking of which, Weeha, point booster already picked up, on his way to it. Won't be the fastest egg climbing, but he's still on a good clip.
So while DC are down in kills, they are up in net worth right now, although it's very small, about 1500 net worth advantage, and at 13 minutes, it's not that much. Then obviously EG looking for a lot of that gold in towers and trying to get that tier 1 tower down bottom, their first tower of the game. They will group up, maybe go for a trade here, as DC is still top with resolution and a couple of heroes wrapping around behind. Lou and Misery, of course, looking for more. Are they both building?
Oh, we have one buckler here. I believe it's Mu building the mech. Misery for now, the value buckler. Curious to see if he goes into a full Crimson Guard, if he just lets this sit. But it does buff them quite a bit in teamfights, and it's very nice to have the bonus armor versus Luna. So I think it's a value pickup for now. Against Illusions, Crimson Guard is really strong, though. So I wouldn't be shocked if he goes into one.
I can see that coming out from Misery. And Misery, of course, you're doing pretty well, all things considered, even in terms of net worth, as support up to 3.5k, and that's something that Misery has always excelled at, farming these heroes.
People think they might want to fight Maunt. They have that song to set things up, but already the tower mid dropping low. EG taking towers uncontested for now. They don't have the mech yet on Mu. You can see DC, as a result, hesitant to engage. Radiant's they will forfeit tower another tower.
They're pushing that top lane, that tier 2. Looks like it will fall. EG not in a position to defend this, and they're just going to give it up. They don't want to deal with resolution or Weeha at this point. So DC will take another tower. Sure, they lose their tier 1 mid, but they gain the access to the top lane with no outer towers there. It's going to be tough for EG to farm this area. They do have that tier 2 mid. We'll see where they head up now. Of course, there is going to be that Dragonlance, as we talked about, being taken for Fury into the double band of Elven Skins now. Just needs the Ogre Club, and for everyone else, starting to farm up and get those items, including Universe, who's got the Vlads now.
EG have done a really nice job of not only taking the tower, but then looking to secure the enemy jungle. Deep wards get planted down. They park Zion Sumail aggressively in the enemy woods on the back of this. A very quiet game for both teams, though, and all the while, Resolution continues to farm, still the leader in net worth as a Razor. 101 CS, this is a FOTA level performance of farming a Razor. A lot of players tend to struggle at keeping their farm up moving later into the game, especially when you're up against heroes like a Luna, a Queen of Pain who flash farm pretty well, even having a Mirana on your own team who takes up a lot of space. But with the BOT build, he can scale into the late game.
Resolution's performances so far this tournament have been on point as well. Mu's a little bit of backstroke,
PPD.
And now they find PPD. They're going to gush him as well. They bring him down to Purifying Flames. He will disrupt himself for the time being, allowing at least
Zion's
to rotate in. It's too late. They kill him with the Starstorm, and Weeha will be able to pick up that and almost his Aghanim Scepter.
Yeah, pretty much the ideal hero for EG to tank the gank. At the same time though, DC didn't use any big cooldowns and it's the Mirana getting the kill. So we, like you mentioned, will have a faster Aghanims as a result. Only one component to go. And with BOTs on Razor, with DC currently out farming EG, no Dominator build on Fear, Void for Universe going for the very standard Vlad's pickup, and Queen of Pain not finding kills, you do wonder how well EG will be able to keep up in a farm war heading later on in the game. At some point, these heroes can flash farm, but their power curve for hitting creeps and killing them quickly is very far behind DC's right now.
It's surprising to me that Sumail has not found these kills, and really maybe it's just the lack of runes. He now has the Invis rune, and with no real vision here for DC, they might get caught out in the jungle. Sumail is coming in, they're looking to, I think, gank.
This Dire Vision could be huge here, they see the Tidehunter!
Jumping in, but the Chronosphere not used yet, move. Now it gets caught by it.
He can solve this.
Thorn comes out, they could song, they're not using it just yet. These Zera bats come through. There's the static link. Looks like a cry start is around. Here comes the ghost ship as well. Nothing going on so far, and we will reset LG.
They're setting up for the Ravage. This could be huge. The arrow as well. The timing is there, but a great disruption by PPD to try and turn the fight universe down. EG gotta back off. Sumail committing the ultimate, unable to find a kill modest to blink away. So Chrono gets blown. Queen of Pain ult committed, and no kills for EG.
That's a one for nothing with like three ultimates, or four actually with the ghost ship. How does it happen?
There's a lot of disengage here for both teams, whether it's Time Walk, Leap, Song, Disruption, even the Kunkobo to mitigate damage, the Queen of Pain blink. But hey, if all the ultimates are getting blown, and DC is the team that walks away with a kill, they're going to be very happy with that.
Yeah, Weehaw now has almost enough for his Aghanim Scepter, and that's a huge item. They have the mech done, it is Misery picking it up. There's a chainmail on the Tidehunter. I think he might just go straight into Blink.
He may opt to go back for either Blink right away, or perhaps we'll consider a Pipe.
Yeah.
Pipe very good against Kunkka, especially the boat alone does 400 AoE damage at level 1. Luna, early to mid game, brings a lot of magic first to the table, or could just go into the Blink and then head straight towards a bigger item pickup, so like a Shiva's Guard. So we'll see what Mu wants to build. Perhaps slight miscommunication for DC, but hey, at least they didn't build two completed mechs.
Yeah, that would have been a huge problem, but I mean, for Misery to have this much farm at this point, 18 minutes, very good for a Naga Siren, obviously. We've seen support Naga Sirens farm fast before, but now this TI, this is the first I've seen support Naga Siren have this mech this early on, and now they're getting ready to go with another potential engagement. There is that ward for EG that might scout things out here as Resolution will walk up with an illusion.
All the scam as well. Well timed by EG. It sees there are heroes behind the Razor, so they won't go in without getting a great setup, which Universe is currently looking for. Chrono there, it's a good position, tough to get around it. Currently, Tidehunter Ravage, 40 seconds up, put up at the Oracle Ultimate, keeps Resolution alive as he backs away, even an Eclipse committed. Razor will pop in the end. Now the turn, can they catch Sumail? Blinking back, DC on the chase, but they lack the Ravage.
It's gonna be Torn coming in, Universe going back in as well. Weehaw getting over the start, they're close up Sumail!
He's got an arrow.
They have the Riptide as well coming through. They want the arrow, almost hits Universe, die. He's able to TP away. No, he gets caught. The Starstorm gets Weehaw a triple kill.
A 4-for-1 exchange and Mott, they did it without the Blink Ravage, which now Mu has. Without even a song for the fight, EG had to commit so much to kill the Razor. They know there's an Oracle on the enemy team. If they don't blow all their spells and he lives with the False Promise, you know you're gonna lose the team fight, but this is another way they can fall short here. We'll see, he backs off. Sumail getting caught there by Weehaw. And then, even though he blinks away, this is where Mirana is very scary. If you don't burst her in fight, she gets off multiple double star storms, can just wreck your team. Almost everyone on EG drops to half health when they group up around her. And as they try to run the net, catching Universe had to dodge the arrow, which meant he wasn't moving directly back as quickly. It allowed Misery to get in range for the net, sets up Weehaw for the triple. Great engagement by DC.
LD, time and time again, we've seen that Aghanim Scepter come out, and as soon as it does, it's a game changer. All the way back to the wild card here at TI6.
They scanned the top lane. They knew there were heroes behind Razor. They didn't 100% know Weehaw now has Aghanim Scepter. They had not seen it until the fight broke out. And it's an item that has caught teams off guard. Does so again here, Mott.
That's huge. Weehaw getting that triple kill. He's already up to 2,000 after picking up that Aghanim Scepter. go into the more of that right-click build that we've seen more and more often as the tournament progresses, or the caster build for the Murana here. And we'll wait and see as they start to push in this tier 2 tower bottom lane, now with an advantage up to 5,000 net worth for DC. Getting tougher and tougher for Evil Geniuses, but they do have great late game as Sumail will pick up an Aghanim Scepter. Here continues to farm.
You just have to worry for EG when Sumail is not having a huge impact. Here's bottom lane, PPD trying to defend the tower, gets caught out, he's gonna set up Weeha for the arrow. Doesn't connect, but doesn't need it either. So PPD falling again. EG reluctant to do much to defend these towers, but Mott, they're gonna have to come back now because DC are threatening high ground. They've got a catapult, Naga illusions here to soak up some tower damage and sustain the siege.
Song, they gotta come ready home as well. You've all these abilities at the ready for DC. EG as well with the clip of the Chronosphere coming out. Here we go. They're gonna find that core, maybe on the Weeha. We'll connect, but Resolution Radiant's pushing them back with the plasma field and doing some nice chip damage. Will they continue on here, LD? Looks like they will.
Yeah, bit by bit, very patient spread here from DC, leaving the Tidehunter far back, the Naga there as well to ensure she gets off the sun. They do not want their heroes that can turn the fight to all get caught by a Chronosphere. I like the way DC positioned the backline in that siege. They don't fully take the tower, but they force EG to come home. One item that will help EG to stall a lot more, which is coming fairly soon for Zai, but is a bit later than normal, is the Armlet. Already has the Blades of Attack, the Gloves of Haste, but he stopped off for Drums and Phase. A lot of times you will just see the Armlet picked up as the first big item. So Zai, once this is up, you can just X yourself, blink in, smack the creep wave to more quickly force DC back and potentially get them into a low HP threshold where you can Chrono and get some kills, but he's not there yet.
We're starting to get to that point in farm where EG might be able to actually, with Fear, getting some more items, including what seems to be a BKB. They can actually start fighting here pretty soon. He's farming the Ancient Stack now. Obviously, they're still pretty far behind with Fear. Starting to catch up, and that's a big item, although Universe burst it down by Weeha in the bottom lane.
Great solo pick there. Weegon is heating up on the big stage, and now boom! He unmoves on EG, catches out three! Zai in trouble, he drops the torch, but they give chase. Resolution sucking up his damage, he's got a lot of move speed while Weeha cleaning up on the backside. He breaks down PPD, the bolt comes through just to protect Zai himself, and he still can't get away! DC grab four! Oh my, Mu, he had the ward to set up that gank. He knew there were heroes near the secret shop and had the confidence for a massive three hero blink ravage.
DC are about to push tier 3 tower, maybe try to take a set of Rex. There is buyback on the Luna, but look at Zai's down for 22 seconds. Chrono not even used there as he got solo picked by the Murana. Sonic Wave will come through, but it does really nothing at this point in time. That did nothing, LD. They're just gonna heal Misery up. They get back together as a team. The glyph is gone now. We'll see if DC really wants to continue this push. It looks like they will back away, confident with what they've accomplished here.
Yeah, they are really hurting EG's farm department now. Sumail opted for the Aghanim Scepter. It's an item that lets you Queen of Pain ult every time the Chrono's up, even if Universe goes for Aghs. He'll still have the 1 minute cooldown to work with. So it makes their team fight potentially stronger, but it's not the best single target burst item. And I think that's what you're seeing now is Resolution, 1900 HP. Even the Murana of Weeha with the Aghanim spilled already, he sits at 1600. Tidehunter roughly around the same mark as well as Mu picks up a point booster. Potential Aghanim spilled for him. They're getting to that point where EG lacks single target burst damage, essentially. You do have Soul Catcher, but there's also great disengage. There's great single target heal from Soxa, who now has a Glimmer Cape as well. And we've seen what he can do in this item. My god, his Winter Wyvern was immaculate.
He's trying to go on Resolution, and there's Demonic Burst coming up to go ship as well. But he talks about how tanky he is, and he's going to try to fight both of these heroes. PPD gunned up, he's going to get chased down. False Promise coming out, Universe looking for a Chronosphere.
He does not want a solo Chrono Mu, and he's going to have to. But Weeha, he finds the back angle, moves on the Fear, the Eclipse coming out. Can Weeha get away? It'll be a huge kill for EG. He's low, he's almost dead, but no!
What a turnaround. Mu blinks out as well, but here comes the Red. They will Sonic Wave and they will pick up the Tidehunter. What a disengage from DC.
Man, Misery to the rescue again. Fantastic song usage there. Saves the Murana. Weeha now with the blink, the BOTs. At this point, Murana generally will build into the shotgun. Could potentially see a BKB if he wants to be a little more durable in the fights. We see he is vulnerable if he tanks all the EG magic damage, but this is just the nature of the DC draft. If they get ahead, they have so many ways to reset the fight and disengage, so many sustain abilities, as well as reset options, and EG just unable to find that clean teamfight execution. Where are the 3-4 hero universe chronos? I think one of the things that's hurting the mod is they haven't had the best vision. Losing all those towers, currently no tier 2 standing, has limited PPD's ability to get on the map when he has gone out to ward. We've seen him get punished and ganked repeatedly. And as a result, universe goes in blind, and they don't have a vision hero really outside of that. Just shadow poison, it's minor at best. Not the easiest lineup for him to set up chronos from while playing from behind, yeah. Unless they go high ground.
This is without a gem for DC as well. They're just getting an advantage through towers and sheer force of will, dropping these wards down. And Sokka and Misery, of course, in that department, making sure that the vision is great, and it is. We'll take down this last outer tower here. The torrent will come through. Resolution sidesteps it. BKB is now done for fear if they want to go out and fight now. Zai's still working on his armlet, getting very close. Back away. The Tidehunter Ravage is back up and available. It's the most important thing. Still no song. That'll be up in about 18 seconds as well. So they have their ultimates coming back off cooldown. And they should get this tier 2, I believe.
Zai, still no armlet. He exes himself, but he just goes home without even really doing anything to slow down the push. And Fear has to build into a BKB. This really limits the Luna's ability to flash farm. It's generally not an item you want to go for at this stage, unless you're five-manning aggressively at their towers and trying to end the game early. See, just a farming Queen of Pain ult in the bottom lane from Sumail. He's also building BKB. This is the Morana. Simply because of Morana existing in the game, Tidehunter a bit as well. But you have to get BKB, but at the same time, you can just play around the BKB cooldowns if you're a Morana. Wait, the song can reset the fight, you blink and leap away. Then when the BKBs are down, you come back in with the shotgun. We saw EG running the carry Morana for Sumail against mass BKBs in that legendary series versus Ehome, and eventually got to the point where they're all 5-second BKBs, and you just kite them, and then you blow heroes up as soon as they wear off. So it's a necessary item, but it is not by any means a guaranteed solution to the burst damage DC has.
And Mook can still catch them off guard. They can blink in with that Ravage, and if he has a good one, I'm sure they won't get off the BKB in time. DC's looking to maybe set this up now. He's going to blink forward. Gosh, he won't go for the Ravage yet.
They want to fight.
Now it's going to go down. Sokka keeping in really aggressively. There's the Chrono on it too, with the Ghost Kid coming in as well. And Sokka's that resolution. Get it blown out. They get the air on Universe, but now we'll need to chase more. EG, they get two.
I'm not sure what was going on there for DC. Sokka TPing in the front lines as an Oracle. That's generally not where you'll see him. May have been expecting Misery to song as we all go for the solo kill in Universe. The quadruple Starstorm not going to be enough, and they exit him.
That's for it. Oh, he avoids it. The Blake Dagger is trying to actually keep you away. Bash is not there. Wow.
Oh, my. If he gets bashed there, DC, hemorrhage, even more gold, but yeah, that was big miscommunication from DC. Sokka TPing in front. Maybe was expecting the Sawn into Ravage setup, but you generally don't want to try to Sawn Ravage at this point because they have so many BKBs on their cores. The Queen of Pain and the Luna now completing them. So from this point forward, that becomes a very unreliable way to take fights. More likely, you either want to wait for the BKBs and then you use that combo, or you just try for the Blink Ravage and get on top of them so they have minimal time to react, as it does have a travel distance the farther away from the Tidehunter's position. But yeah, DC, miscommunication there. Good news for them is Morana did not go down. Razor still farming like a champ. Resolution now with the BKB completed. So their cores continue to get farmed, but still, when you're this far ahead as DC, they were over 10,000 gold up. You give up a lot with just a couple of kills.
Yeah. I mean, Resolution is still farming well, and he's still top the net worth. That is a critical death going his way. And like you said, Zoxa caught out with that Chronosphere as well. Shouldn't have been there, but...
And it's going to be a one-minute Chrono fairly soon, Mon. Already Universe with the Ogre Club. At that point, the Queen of Pain Ags becomes devastating. These two can just hook up every minute and find basically a free kill on us support.
You have to be careful for DC. A little bit tankier. Resolution's already done a fair bit of that. Misery is going to have to be very diligent with the Song of the Siren against Universe. Again, though, the BKBs are up and out for EG now. He's starting to get those items. And again, Roshan has not been really an objective for either of these teams. Neither of these teams really great at Roshan, at least not yet. Luna a little bit better later on down the road with Gush. Obviously, you have some armor reduction for DC, but not much. So taking Roshan at this point for either team might be a bit too early for that, but they do want to keep tabs on that Roshan area around that pit. Radiant's and G will continue to push bottom, as well as the top lane push coming out from DC, trying to force some heroes back.
So now Moot, it's kind of a schizophrenic item build. He was going towards a mech earlier, now he builds into the hood after the point booster. seems like he's very indecisive about what he wants here. Does he want... Did he want a mech? Does he want a pipe? Was he going for an axe? It's a bit of everything, but he hasn't gotten that one big item just yet that could make the difference. EG, meanwhile, they're looking decisive, Mott. Naga Illusion here trying to scout things out, but they could get the jump on Mu. It would be huge. Good positioning, though. Look at Misery in the back.
We're gonna go for Weeha, potentially Universe of Smoke is broken, Chronosphere on the two, Misery being trained on from Blink Ravagin, catches out a couple, but Smail has his BKB, they instare him, however, the fight's still going okay for DC now, LD.
Weeha's alive, and he's looking to come back in, he's got the Starstorm available, and Clips ready now, but Resolution tanking his way through this, he's far too difficult to burst for now, gets off the Static Link, Shadow Demon has to buy back, and now the reset, Song for Misery, Weeha, maybe gonna set up, but the song will end, they got it back away. Here it seems DC indecisive. Do they want to fight? Do they want to run? They fight two males. They get the quad.
And they bring him down quickly. They're not saying yet. PPT might die back here if he's not careful.
We're still chasing him. Mirana is ramping up the longer this fight goes. Weeha's going to take over. Beer barely able to escape. But now the ultimates are down. Mirana's still going to be strong as ever. The Void Axe is not done yet. A full minute where that's unavailable. And DC, behind the Razor, this frontline tanker, they may be looking to push. Indeed they are. Nope. No Eclipse. BKB's on cooldown. A very tough defense right now for EG.
No buyback for Smail. He's up in 30 seconds. Weeha just jumps and gets the double Starstorm on two. And now they're looking to take Rax. Lip, I don't think should be available. Arrow coming through. Hits Universe. Not a long duration, but they will go for it. Zyflo as well.
Good zoning by DC.
Back. Everyone is back.
They just want the Rax for now. The melee dropping low. DC, the first Rax of the lower bracket finals is theirs. They claim it while all tier 2 stand. And they now catapult themselves into a quite decisive advantage. Over 12,000 gold ahead. Universe hunting for something as he moves forward. And what a critical time to find that fight mod before the Void Axe. If Void has Axe, EG might get a second shot at that fight. But because it's not up yet, The one fight not decisive enough for them, they had no plan B at that point. And now, to make things a lot more difficult, Mu, he does complete his first big item, grabbing the pipe. This will mitigate a lot of EG's damage output. They still lack heavy physical damage. Luna's is getting there, but with the build Fear's gone for, it's a slow build-up.
You see it even with Zai, just getting the combination. It's just too much damage to deal with at that point in time, so... Magical damage of the ghost ship, as well as the torrent, nice to block, as well as the scream of pain. If you take that out with that pipe, this is going to allow them to siege with more, I guess,
more calls.
Yeah, I think at that point, then you're just ready to go. I think they would like to have an Aegis as well, but again, they don't take it that fast. And maybe get a pick and try to go for it there. And Fear is getting chased down by Weeha. He's going to have to TP away. Arrow if he hits it, but no, it's on cooldown for 3 seconds. Won't be able to find the pick off. Fear will get away.
EG, definitely looking a bit shaken after that, moving around as a pack of four. They know one more bad fight with all the tier 2s brought down, either means of DC Aegis, EG buybacks, or potentially a second lane of Rax. Any of these things tips the game even further in DC's favor when they're already in control. Now up to 14,000 gold. I'm looking at what DC needs to break a second lane of Rax. To me, the big thing is Resolution completing the Assault Cuirass. At that point, Pipe, AC, tanky cores, you have a Glimmer Cape, Oracle great at keeping heroes alive in fights. Everyone on DC generally elusive in their own right. I think even if EG hits a good combo, they struggle to find kills, assuming just one of those defensive abilities gets off.
But it's going to be big. They're going to run right into each other. Fear and Weeha will spot each other first, not committing to the fight. And here comes Resolute from the side. BKB pops. He wants PPD, and he's already getting chased down. He has to self-destruct. Great Chrono on the two, but he doesn't hit move. The Song setting this up. Here we go. The Sonic Wave coming through.
They want the Oracle, but it's not quite enough. Zoxa stays alive. He gets on the Bone Province. They turn up Sumail. Resolution hitting for almost 350 a pop here, flashing down Fear. He'll drop the Luna, 3 a falling. EG have been denied again by Misery, and on design they go. A triple for Rezo, and GG! EG get shut down by DC in game one. They got their Universe Void, 11-0 coming into this game. But now it's 11-1.
They had answers at every turn. DC seemed to be ready at every moment. And EG, they couldn't find the farm for Luna. They couldn't find the farm for Sumail. And it just wasn't there during the team fights. And DC, some great team play. The Song resets, the Mu ravages, it all coming together at the perfect time for this squad.
a mixture of smiles and very business-like looking from them as they walk off the stage. But they know this is only game one. This is a best of three. And still, Wings are waiting.